Sedin is going to the box. Now Dan Boyle from center. In for Thornton. Thornton shoots. Saved by Snyder. They score! Looking back at the referees, he didn't like that call against Sedin. You can't blame him.
You see, Cheech and Gary, Len Vigneault agrees with you. 4-3 in overtime. Patrick Marleau scores the winner after the penalty, the controversial penalty to Daniel Sedin in overtime. As far as the Canucks being swept, well, they've been swept four times in franchise history, first by the Islanders in the 82 Stanley Cup Final, then by the Blackhawks. Remember Chris Chelios scoring two game-winning goals in overtime in that series. The Avalanche in 0-1 when Marcus Naslund had a broken leg, and then what you just saw over the past week or so, the San Jose Sharks in this Western Conference quarterfinal. And
it's exciting. Going down 3-2 in the third, and then it's huge getting that third one, but to win an overtime like that, it's special, and well-deserved series win for us. Yeah, I don't know who was on my left side, but I wanted to give it actually to him, and then he just kind of took away whoever that was, and I just shot, and just good thing Patty has wheels to finish that off, but it was a good decision.
We were getting chances, we were playing in their end, and we were able to draw a penalty and score on the power play. Tommy's he's big for us, he's an important piece of our puzzle, and gets in on four checks, finishes checks, gets under the other team's skin, and they went after him tonight and took some undisciplined penalties.
In the meantime, we don't really know the future. My Lord, it's up in the air. Len Vigneault's future with the Vancouver Canucks, given the fact the Canucks have lost 10 of their, make that 11 of their last 12 playoff games, and got swept here by San Jose after losing in the first round to the Los Angeles Kings last year. We don't know his future, but we do know his present. He is down in San Jose addressing the media after the 4-3 overtime loss.
Well, it's the call that the far referee obviously thought was the right call, and we had to kill it, and we didn't.
You did have some history with that official this year. He called an unsportsmanlike on you in Calgary, led to a game-winning goal. A few days later, you said, called him by name and said you just thought he made a mistake. Do you think there was some carryover here?
Well, you're not asking the right guy. You should ask the referee. As far as I'm concerned, I mean, every game's a new slate, and that's what the rules are supposed to be.
Did you get any explanation from anyone?
No.
I think your team saved its very best period of hockey for the third period tonight. Why did it take so long to get there for your club?
Well, I think you got to give credit where credit is due, and San Jose played real solid hockey. I mean, again, I think we were pretty evenly matched 5-on-5, but their power play was definitely a weapon that caused us a lot of trouble and gave them a lot of momentum. And we just weren't good enough.
Elaine, just how disappointing though is this series loss for you guys? I mean, certainly, obviously, you were predicted to go farther than this and to be out in four games.
Well, anytime you're eliminated in the playoffs, it's not easy. And we met a good team. We battled hard, but they were the better team.
Elaine, Daniel said this one hurt more than maybe even losing to Boston, and he thought it was because they inflicted it a bit on themselves by not giving that effort right at the very beginning of game one. Do you agree with any of that?
Well, I think at this time players are real emotional, and it's a tough loss for everyone, players, coaches, management, and owners, and we'll take a couple of days here to analyze how this series went and what we did in the regular season and go from there.
You talk to the team after the game at all, Coach, or do you save that for another day?
No, I mean, there's a lot of disappointment, and there wasn't the right time.
Coach, can you take us through your thought process on your starting goalie tonight?
Well, like I mentioned yesterday, Schneid's is our MVP, in my opinion, this year, and he always had good bounce-back games, and it's what we were counting on, and he gave us a chance tonight. Thanks, guys.
I thought an emotional Alain Vigneault. That's what I read anyway. In the wake of the 4-3 overtime loss for the Canucks down in San Jose, the Canucks have been swept in the first round by the Sharks. Don Taylor back with John Garrett and Gary Volk. Okay, guys, let's get into it. Going into that press conference, I talked about Alain Vigneault's future with the Vancouver Hockey Club. Did he coach his last game tonight?
Unfortunately, I think he probably has. Would I agree with the decision? It's easier to get rid of the coach than your core players.
Yep.
That's a tough thing to do. But look at his record. I mean, he's been absolutely just win-win-win, except the last two playoff years, where the expectations are so high that I think that's going to be his downfall. And he's had the core group of players with him for his entire tenure, from the Winnipeg days right through. And
Manitoba Moose.
And you look at the development of the players and what Alain Vigneault's done for Kevin Bieksa, Ryan Kessler,
Burroughs.
And Alex Burroughs, and Henrik and Daniel Sedin, Hanson. And Alex Edler and Hanson. I mean, he's done a great job making those guys stars in this league. And yet, the bottom line is winning. Mm-hmm. And as much as the coach can try and will the team to win, he has to get them. He has to get them motivated. He has to get them to have that playoff drive. And, Gary, you know what it's like. And a former player, you have that player adrenaline. Mm. And Alan's a former player.
Yep.
You have that. You want to be. And the closest thing to playing is coaching. And you get that adrenaline going. You go, come on. And yet there's nothing. And there comes a time when you've got the same bunch of guys. How do I reach them? Yeah. How do I get to them? And I think,
Has he reached that point?
He might be at that point.
Well, it's tough. They're in a tough position, this organization. I mean, back when I played in Toronto for 4 years, we get to the Final Four twice. We had over 100 points each of the years we were there. We're putting up the division banners. We had good teams. Pat Quinn was at the helm. Everybody wanted Pat Quinn out. They weren't happy. We weren't getting results. And we always won a round. Still, they wanted to get rid of Pat Quinn. We never got swept in the first round like Alain Vigneault has. But they wanted the change. Well, then they don't make the playoffs for, what is it, 9 years, and finally they're back in it this year. Look, the bottom line is there's 30 teams in this league. 14 don't make it. Okay? Only 8 of them make the second round. Only one of them wins the Stanley Cup. Regular seasons, yeah, people are sick of hearing it because they've had good teams. Wait till Vancouver doesn't have a good team in the regular season. Then they'll be complaining about regular seasons as well. I think Alain Vigneault, I don't agree with all of his moves, but I do agree with the majority of them, and he has the players buying in, or else you're not putting up banners during the regular season.
Do you agree with John that he's coached his last game?
He's going to be gone. I think he will be gone, but to replace him will not be easy.
Okay. Now, we can talk all we want about coaching. Coaching is only good as the players who play for him. And the person who's acquiring those players, what about the job Mike Gillis has done?
Well, the thing is with the general manager is you're entrusting your players to the coach. Mm-hmm. And are the players good enough? Well, the players won back-to-back President's Trophies. They've won 5 straight division titles. Yeah. So as general manager, Mike Gillis can say, well, hey, the players are good enough. We've done this. Now, Mike Gillis has been loyal. He's Alain Vigneault, there was a lot of people last year LA series that wanted Alain Vigneault to be gone. And Mike Gillis, no, he's my coach. And it's going to be a lot harder this year. And I think Mike Gillis has to look long and hard and say, okay, is it time? And how many general managers don't get to at least fire one coach and get another voice in the room? And I think that's Mike Gillis, the team has done so well. Mm-hmm. And that's the
Mike Gillis does have to thank his owners as well. I mean, they've spent to the cap maximum at all times. Any little scientific thing this team has ever needed as far as sleep doctors or different time machines or whatever they have, the owners have always bucked up and paid everything. They've had the best hotels, the best meals, the best everything. Mike Gillis has gone to him and said, look, we need this, we need that, we need that player. And they've done it. You got to hand the Aquilinis a lot of credit. Are they going to have the patience
to sit by
with Mike Gillis? I know Mike Gillis is their guy, but he had no experience as a GM coming into this. So he took over a very good team. He added a few pieces to it. They got to a cup final. From that cup final till now, a lot of the moves he's made have not been very good. And what might seal the fate for Mike Gillis is what he's done or lack of done with Roberto Luongo. Mm-hmm. Because Roberto Luongo, I guarantee it, they're not going to want to buy him out and write a $30 million check get rid of him. They're not going to want to see him. Look, one of the only ways to get rid of Roberto is if the Vancouver Canucks have to eat some of his salary. That's maybe what it comes down to. The Aquilinis will not be happy with that.
But he's got 8 years left in his contract.
He does have 8 years left in his contract.
They'll have to eat some of the contract.
You know what they should do? They should go back into one of those time machines you talked about and redo that contract.
A Star Trek. You're always the movie, like the Star Trek. I'm going to see the new Star Trek movie for sure. But Francesco Aquilini is a big fan. Not only is
of Luongo.
Of the team.
Of the team. Of course,
and hockey in general. I mean, Francesco is one of the biggest fans that the Vancouver Canucks have, besides being the owners. And he likes to be involved, and he likes to have his opinion heard. And I'm sure he's going to listen to everybody around him. And the Roberto Luongo thing is he'll get Mike Gillis to make some kind of deal. And you look at Pittsburgh's goaltending. To me, that would be, if they lose to the Islanders.
Well, we heard the same stuff last year that they were going to.
Yeah, but a short season. And to me, the short season hurt the Vancouver Canucks more than just about any other team. You look around the league and the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Columbus Blue Jackets and teams that were real surprises in a 48-game season. I think it hurt the Vancouver Canucks. They had the fewest guys play overseas. They started the season 3 days after training camp started. Ryan Kessler wasn't there. They never got Derek Roy comes in. They never had time to get him acclimated.
Less time to get the Luongo deal done.
Less time to trade deadline.
And the Luongo deal was, how does a team know that their goaltending stinks in a 48-game season? You can survive. You can throw your other guy in there, and you've got a guy in the minors. You don't know. But an 82-game season in January, you know, okay, we have to make a deal for a goalie. And they 48-game season.
Do you think Francesco knows what Mike Gillis turned down last summer for Roberto Luongo?
Well, he has to know.
Yes.
Do you think he knows?
Right? He's the owner
of the team.
I'm
sure he's part of that decision as well.
Yeah.
So then maybe he'll stick with Mike Gillis because he was part of the decision what they turned down.
I think we can
I guarantee you they turned down some good players for him last
summer. Well, I think we can all agree that Alain Vigneault, Mike Gillis, everybody's under scrutiny after the last two playoff seasons. It's been a complete a disappointment. Let's be honest here. Postseason-wise, anyway. But they can't go through another season wondering about what's going to happen with Roberto Luongo. But I got to ask you this question. I know we're running out of time here, at least to go to break. They can't sell this team next year, can they, John? There's some problems selling tickets this year. Can you sell Alain Vigneault next year? Can you sell Mike Gillis? Can you sell Sedins, Roberto Luongo? I don't think you can.
No, and that's another reason that I think Alain Vigneault's job is in jeopardy is the fact that and there are certain media outlets that have been crying for his head from the start of the season.
Right.
I think it's easier to get rid of the coach than to get rid of some of these core players.
Sure.
Seven or eight of them have no trade clauses.
But it'll have to be a somebody. You can't bring in
Lindy Ruff's available.
The guy from Buffalo.
Yeah. Lindy Ruff.
Ron Wilson.
Not Lindy Ruff, but the guy that Buffalo hired, he just signed today, Ralston or somebody. Troy G. Ward, who I think is a very good coach, coaching Abbotsford in the American League. You can't bring in somebody like that. It has to be a name
that you can sell.
People recognize and you can sell. It can't be, he's the best junior coach in the country. That's not going to work here in Vancouver. This is an elite team that needs an elite coach. And I think that was one of the things that Toronto did right, Gary, was, who do you get? Oh, Ron Wilson. Who do we get? Randy Carlyle. Mm-hmm. You get a name.
And guys that are good with the media.
Michelle Therrien.
Yeah.
Paul McLean in Ottawa. You look
they're
at the
all
guys.
Taken. Who's available? It's Lindy Ruff and who else is there?
There'll be some.
The search begins. And, of course, Lord knows there's going to be a firing or two after the National Hockey League playoffs are over.